I had astonishing dreams last night, and it means that great good fortune is coming my way. But this is stressful, isn't it? We always think that we want great good fortune, but when it actually comes our way, it's a big change, big change. Imagine a sailor who's been out on the turbulent ocean, real stormy, choppy ocean, and the boat is constantly heaving and like this, right? Constantly heaving in different directions, pitching and yawing and heaving. And imagine that boat slowly sailing into a harbor, and it gets the chop gets worse, less and less and less, less and less chop, smoother and smoother water, and eventually they come into this harbor that's absolutely smooth and calm, totally calm water. Now the gradualness of coming in solves the continuity problem. See, now if we took this sailor out on the rough ocean, who's been out on the rough ocean for eons, you know, just so long, and we suddenly, instantly shifted them to the calm harbor, utterly calm harbor, they would freak out. They would freak out. They'd say, wow, what's happening to my identity? What's happening to my world? You know, they're totally adjusted to all the pitching and the heaving and like this, the boat. They're adjusted to that. And if you have absolutely calm smoothness, they'll feel like, whoa, what's going on? I'm terrified. That's called the continuity problem. Continuity problem. We know when we get off a boat that's been really choppy and we get on land, we can hardly walk. We're stumbling around, right? That's just a little example of a continuity problem. We have this severe continuity problem. So, pragmatically, we cannot be that sailor on the rough seas instantly awakening in the calm harbor. Pragmatically, that's not going to happen for us. Theoretically, of course, we could. In a dream, we can make any shift we want to. But from the standpoint of a continuity problem we have, what we have to do is we have to sail in towards the harbor, and it's a graduated harbor where the water gets calmer and calmer and calmer and calmer, and we sail in slowly so we can get used to it. It's just like that. That's the continuity issue that we face, which is why a spiritual path is necessary for us. Don't fall prey to those prideful ones who say, I don't have any continuity problem. I'm just going to go out and venture in delusion as much as I want, and then I'll just shift right back to enlightenment, just like that. That's easy to talk that way when you're going out into delusion, as it were, into the choppy seas. Ah, this is fun. This is adventure. I know I can just instantly, you know, shift to the calm harbor. And as they keep going on their adventure more and more and more, they keep saying, no, I don't have any problem. And then they say, okay, I'm tired of this. And they say, okay, time to shift back. Whoops, what's that? That's a problem. And then it hits them. Oh my gosh, what happened? And then they start thinking, oh my gosh, there is no safe harbor. God has abandoned me. And all these delusions then suddenly, these defenses of the continuity fear arise. And then they really get into heavily defended condition. This is what happens. So you have those spirits who are kind of new to this self-delusion, trying to create separate from God, who are really confident, say, hey, we don't have any problem. This is just fun. It's an adventure. We're seeing what we can do. And then you have those who have realized they have this severe continuity fear, and they begin rationalizing and defending against it. And then you have, so there's just a massive egoic defense of claiming God is trying to punish us, or God is wrathful, angry with us, and all this, delusion. And then you have those on the spiritual path. And then you have those who are finishing the spiritual path, or who have finished it. The four bears, I call them the four bears. Had a dream of four bears last night. Yeah. So this is really the situation that we face. You see those who seem so bold and confident and arrogant and just this lust for life, existence, right? This lust for existence, just say, what? You know, just grabbing it with two fists and just say, wow, all you, you know, timid people out there, you're so, what's the matter with you? I'm the this great hero here. I'm adventuring here. This is fantastic. And you have the ones who are fearful of God in this very highly defended state with strange religious teachings, etc. All right, you have those because they've recognized they have a continuity problem and they don't know how to solve it. And so they're trying to get rid of God. They say, wow, God is bad. God has changed, you know, I can't go back. And then the third bear is, hey, the Holy Spirit can help me with the continuity. I have a severe continuity problem, but there's a resolution to it. The vision of oneness is the resolution to it. The Holy Spirit is with me. And so I'm now working on resolving the continuity problem. That's the third bear. The fourth bear is finishing the spiritual path and realizing that we never left the calm waters. In fact, they're only calm waters. There is no choppy sea at all. Everything is infinite calm, endless, perfect calm, vision of oneness. Not only did we never leave the harbor, there are no choppy seas at all. Everything is immaculately calm and peaceful. This is the awakening. So the fourth bear grooms you to awaken. That's what the bear was doing to me. A very friendly, kind bear, and the bear was grooming my hair. My head here, it was like, I said, what are you doing, bear? And I realized it was grooming me. You know, being groomed means you're being prepared for the fourth state, which is awakening. The first state is the adventure of falling into delusion, thinking this is a grand adventure. The second state is recognizing that you have this, you have this continuity fear, but not really understanding it. So you defend against it. That's the second state. The third state is you realize you have a severe continuity fear, but the Holy Spirit is with you and is going to orchestrate your spiritual path and your ultimate freedom from the continuity fear. It's going to evaporate it gradually. The fourth state is awakening and to this infinite calm. Realizing it was all a dream, it was all zero. Zero times zero, nothing ever happened. So this is how a way to look at the overall situation. What I try to do with these videos is reassurance and encourage everyone to get the big picture. The more you can get the big picture, the more you can calm down. The more you calm down, you say, oh, it's not all out of control. I mean, there is this obvious situation, actually. It's just that, one, we kind of are in awe of those who are falling into the adventure of self-deception, this grand adventure of trying to create separately from God, this whimsical, and they seem like, wow, you know, gods and goddesses with this great lust and intensity, and they feel no fear, you know, it's just like, wow, there's all of that taking place. There are those who then have realized, wait, you know, I can't create separately from God. It's futile. I'm so tired of it, but I can't go home, so I'm going to turn to the ego and make all these excuses and rationalizations and try to find some way to combine truth and lies. And there's this, so that becomes a swamp of confusion. So there's this vast swamp of confusion in existence. Okay, that's the second aspect of existence. The bold adventurers, the vast swamp of confusion. Then the wisdom that the Holy Spirit gives once you realize, you turn to the Holy Spirit once you realize that the swamp of confusion won't save you either. Then you turn to the Holy Spirit and it says, don't worry. I know, I understand the entire situation. I will evaporate your fears, continuity fears. Then the wisdom, The wisdom arises from that. So you have this vast body of wisdom also in existence, spiritual path wisdom. And then you have those who are in this immaculate calm. Examples, you know, showcases, examples of the Holy Spirit's work. And you say, you know, wow, how's that possible? It's amazing. But you know it's possible. When you become on the spiritual path, you know somehow the Holy Spirit is going to evaporate your fear and you're going to awaken, but you just don't know, how is this possible? And yet it is possible. And so you keep working at it. Had a dream last night also. I traded in my car for this other car. And this other car was just like so amazing. It would manifest anything I wanted, this car. And the way it did, it was just incredible. I said, what? Whatever I needed, the car would manifest it for me. It's a vehicle of manifestation. So I was trading in, you know, one car for this other classic, wonderful, beautiful classic. And, you know, the styling was spacious styling to it. And it wasn't all this modern stuff, but it was just sort of a classic, open, spacious, comfortable car without all the bells and whistles. And yet it had this console where you could simply ask for whatever you wanted and it would appear, and the car would manifest anything to give you exactly what you wanted. Whatever experience you wanted, the car would simply provide it for you. And I was getting used to this car, this new car. It wasn't new in the sense that it just the latest model. It was new to me, but it looks like the car had been around, you know, for forever. I mean, it's a classic style. It seems, you know, wasn't like it had just been manufactured, nothing like that. And yet nothing was run down about the car. All the chrome was still perfect chrome, you know, everything was still, like, you know, looked like it was unblemished, untouched, stainless. But it was not the high-tech stuff that we have now. It was not. It was older style without any of the, you know, high technology that we have. Like I said, I couldn't figure out, you know, how is it producing, doing all these things without any of the technology? But it was. And the car just said, hey, let's go cruising. Let's just go. I said, yeah, because whatever I want, the car can arrange it. Whatever is needed, the car simply arranges it. I need a glass of water. A glass of water was a little kind of like a glove compartment in the middle of the console. You can just open it up, and there's the glass of water for you to drink. You put it back in, it disappears. So there's no clutter. I said, I need a map of the area, of the golf courses. Open the console, and this map drops right out of the console of all the different courses and all the information, just like that. And then you put it back in, it disappears again. There's no clutter. So Even if I needed somebody to help me, some person just appeared. It manifested a person, the person helped me do something, and then it disappeared. So, you get confidence in a car like that. The car somehow is a miracle car. I guess if it needed a bridge, it would just manifest a bridge and drive right across the bridge. Go, if there's some need to go across a river or something, the bridge is out, I'll just go right, just manifest a bridge. And I like driving it, I like driving it. Someone is selling this Mercedes convertible, this older style, very beautiful looking. You know, the early 90s or something when they really made them great. And I looked at the car, I said, wow, I'd like to drive that. It's a timeless classic quality style sort of thing. But most of us now want to drive the latest and the greatest models, full of all this technological, you know, gadgetry. But I'd rather just drive a car that manifests whatever I want, whatever's needed. And no bells and whistles. I just express what it is that I want, and the car responds exactly. Gives me whatever I want. Very nice vehicle. No need to go fast. Just put the top down. Just cruise calm, smooth, quiet, smooth ride. You know, just feel very calm driving the car. Very calm. Today it's like rabbits everywhere on the road, right? Driving does not feel like a calm experience. It used to be we relished the smooth calmness of driving. On that smooth asphalt road, the breeze, and just going quietly and smoothly. That feeling, we used to love that. Wide open roads in California. But now, it's a frantic rat race. And all these, you know, cars designed for that now are just zipping around. It's just like, you have to keep from getting angry at people because they're just disregarding all the rules of the road. I end up just saying, wow, wow, look at that, huh? Just absorb the wow of it, wow. Cars used to symbolize peacefulness. Get out of a frantic house, the televisions or music blaring, everybody's conflicted and yelling. You get in your car, it's all quiet. You go out on a tree-lined road, and you're just smoothly driving. You know, maybe you have some soft music, air conditioner's on. Maybe you have a soft drink or something to drink. And you're just peacefully gliding along, just peacefully gliding through space like that. And it reminds us of something. Now people jump in the car, going somewhere, whoa, like that, whoa. They're weaving their way, can I go a little faster, can I gain a second here? Oh, here's a light, let me speed up, let me get through that, and let me get around this here. It's all like strategic. Go, 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 go. If you want to know what the future is like, just live in the Silicon Valley. That's what the future of the world is going to be like, because this is where the brains of the future live. This is where the designers of the future live. This is where all the high-tech companies, all the brain power of the world is. Now I can tell you, it is terrible. Now for the bold adventure types who haven't gotten kicked in the teeth enough to realize, hey, we can't separate from God. This is just a futile, useless, aimless wandering in sickness, suffering, and death, and we're just symbolizing all the separation, right? So we're trying to symbolize it's possible. So we're constantly being separated from everything we think we want, all our valuing. And eventually it just becomes like this huge roaring suffering in our mind. They haven't reached that stage yet. So they're newbies, as it were. So they think, you know, hey, you got the world by the tail. The world is our oyster. Definitely don't want a world designed by those types, because you just get deeper and deeper and deeper into continuity fear. And they say, hey, don't worry, we got the remedy for you. Just keep adventuring more and more and more, deeper, deeper, deeper. That is not smart. It is incredibly foolish. Incredibly foolish. And you'll regret it later, severely regret it later. You say, wow, why didn't anyone tell me? You know, why did? Well, I'm telling you right now. I'm telling you the world right now. Not that many are listening, but if you can, for a moment, realize that God is not wrathful, that God is real, but is not wrathful, is not angry, is not scary. None of that is true. God simply is this total calm isness of everywhereness, totally untroubled. Then you can say, well, then where is all this fear coming from? And you can say, it must be coming from my continuity problem. I'm afraid of this perfect isness because I've been trying to separate. I've been in this duality of separation and trying to value separation and deal with all this choppy oceans of relativity. And I'm afraid of experiencing this isness, this perfect calm of the isness. So I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem. Then all of the other problems begin to evaporate into this, realize they're just, I only have this one problem. The other ones are not even important, not even, have no value to me whatsoever, really no value. It's like continuing to multiply zero by numbers. You realize that doesn't have any value for me, does it? So do I need to argue about, no, like 20 is the right number to multiply zero by? And somebody else says, no, 25. Am I going to get into a big war over, is it 20 or 25 times zero? Which one has the real value? You say, no, neither one has any value. 20 times zero, zero. 25 times zero, zero. So neither one has any value to me. And then you're able to generalize that and say, none of these quantities of has any value times zero. None of these values has value. None of these, it's not worth any thought to differentiate between all these presumed values of separation when they're all actually being multiplied by zero. So why do I need to engage my mind in all this mental activity of trying to figure out and judge the differences between 1,000 times zero and 10,000 times zero? Say, okay, you know, which has more value? Is it more valuable to have a large quantity of separation or more valuable to have a little quantity of separation? What's the difference between the two? You know, how do I combine the two? Maybe we'll combine the two and make it 5,000 in, or should I shade it this way or that way? How do I play this? This tumultuousness of this attempt to separate from God, create separate from God, this tumultuousness of duality. It's always tumultuous. Now again, there's some who are newbies who say, I love this challenge, adventure, I'm grabbing the tumultuousness, look at this, this is great, look at these huge waves smashing down, oh, this is like, this is fun. Don't get fooled by those. Don't get fooled by those. Later on, you'll see them cowering somewhere in a church saying, please God, don't kill me, don't be so angry at me, I'm such a terrible sinner, you know, I know you want to crush me like a bug, but, you know, crush Jesus instead and save me, and they'll have all these defenses, you know. No, I'm just a body. I'm just this terrible body, and you have to change reality to suit me. And they'll be cowering in fear. Okay, so why? What happened? Inevitably, right? Inevitably, because they get tired of all these waves crashing down. They say, I think I'll have some other adventure. And they say, uh-oh, what's this fear? What's this fear I have? I didn't used to have that fear. What is this? Continuity fear. Then they plunge into the adventure of defending against this. Say, no, I don't have any fear. I'm fearless. It's, you know, God is punishing me. God doesn't like me. You know, all this stuff. and then later on you'll see them on the spiritual path. And they seem wise. They seem wise. So we all go through these cycles. We all go through these cycles. You get too many newbies in a world, though, and they end up, you know, plunging the whole world along the wrong path. We don't want that. And one of the expressions of these newbies is technology, high technology. Is they say, hey, I don't have any fear. I don't have a continuity fear. This is my home. I love it. I relish it. I relish all the death and misfortune and accidents and arguments and disputes and conquest and being destroyed. I relish all this stuff. This is great. You know, we can make this place wonderful. Let's design everything the way we want to design it. You know, that's an expression, again, of their pride, spiritual pride and self-delusion. The pride in self-delusion, thinking they can delude themselves to such an extent that delusion becomes real. See, they believe they can make the dream real and reality the dream. This is what they believe. And so all this technology is an expression of that. They're working on all these technically sophisticated vehicles, which means androids. Tell you, you know, let's be blunt about this. Cyborgs, androids. The grays, a lot of these grays are actually technically engineered androids that the reptilians are sending into this world. And the tall white grays have these little slaves, basically. Throwing up grass. He ate a bunch of grass. And suddenly had a reaction that, okay. Wow. Keep the calm. Calm is still here. Stay off the grass. You see these bold, adventurous, prideful ones tell you that there's something wrong with you, that you're afraid. And so so they say, hey, there's a way to cure that. Just take drugs. Don't worry, we're designing a world you'll be happy. Just take drugs and pretty soon you'll realize how great we are. So people get on drugs. Because they don't realize the continuity fear. Once you realize that you have a continuity fear, you get off drugs. You get off drugs for sure. Once you turn to the Holy Spirit, you get off drugs. You also usually get off pharmaceuticals eventually. You know, I don't take anything. We're getting ready for an earthquake in California, and so we're getting all these supplies for people, and there's so many medicines and so much stuff. And like for me, I don't have anything. I mean, just water. Give me some water and you know, I don't know, some ramen. That's it. Really, pretty much is it. I don't think in terms of medicines and any of that stuff. So the scourge of drugs in the world comes from the spiritual pride that is in the world. And saying, don't worry, we're here to save you. We're gonna design a great world, you're gonna love it. And the people are saying, wow, I really hate this world, it's terrible. And they say, no, don't worry, we're gonna entertain you, we're gonna got all the stuff you need. Just meanwhile, take these drugs and that'll help you feel better. Oh, okay. Anyway. So we're designing all these snazzy cars, high-tech people, the reptilians designing the greys to do the dirty work for them, basically dangerous, dirty work. And they say, this is the vehicles you need. These vehicles can have wireless technology. These vehicles can have built-in GPS and computers. These vehicles can do all this kind of stuff. And you think, oh, I don't need to go back home. I don't have a continuity problem. I can stay on this choppy ocean and, you know, have a nice cabin on this choppy ocean. All sorts of bells and whistles. And so the world is getting seduced into this. You know, robots. I have zero interest in robots, zero interest in cyborgs, androids, artificial intelligence. No interest in any of that. No interest whatsoever in a future that has anything to do with that. And of course, the whole Silicon Valley is completely obsessed with that. Why? Spiritual pride. They don't want to admit they have a continuity problem. I said, no, I should be able to adventure however I want to and not have any fear. Well, if you try to change what you are and your strategy is to simply insist this is possible for as long as you possibly can and imagine that you are going through this, you've been going through a transformational process that does change what you are, and believing that belief will make it real, and believing for such a long time and so intensely, then you're gonna think that reality is completely make-believe and hostile to you. And so then you will have a continuity problem. You will have a fear of waking up from the dream. This is what everyone overlooks. They overlook it. And so they keep denying, no, I don't have any fear within me. It's out there. I'm being persecuted. You know, God is persecuting me, eventually they say. God is angry with me. God is causing catastrophes and earthquakes and tornadoes. No, God is causing all this stuff. Instead of, I'm trying to project my continuity fear out into the world and see it as something else. You know, not see the causation. They don't want to admit that. They don't want to admit that they're fearful. Well, we have a continuity fear which can be evaporated. Once it's evaporated, then we'll realize that we truly are fearless in terms of our freedom. We're not no longer afraid of our freedom. But we do understand that when we try to imprison our freedom, that results in a continuity fear. So the one fear that we can experience is the continuity fear. But that only arises when we try to imprison ourselves, imprison our freedom through, you know, time-space, believing there's such a thing as time-space. Time-space, the space of time. See, all of this space is the space of presumed time. But there isn't any time. Time meaning choices that are not free, that are bound to one another through the so-called link we call time. There are no choices that are linked. We're totally free. So what we're looking at is not really time-space at all. It's pure spaciousness. This is where the vast calm comes in. This is the awakening to pure spaciousness. So there are those who are awakened. Who are aware of us on the spiritual, where we're at, and they help us to get help. It's ultimately all the grace of God, the Holy Spirit. Now, we misinterpret this based on, you know, where we're at, like the bold adventurer ones, the first bears who are thinking they can make self-delusion real. You know, they claim someone may have been enlightened. They say, yeah, they're enlightened, but they enlightened themselves. For instance, they say that Buddha did it all by himself. That's not true. Buddha was enlightened by the grace of God. We're all enlightened by the grace of God. There's no such thing as we did it ourselves. Even the first one who does it, it's the grace of God that does it, always. We can call the grace of God whatever we want to call it. You know, so we can call it the Holy Spirit, or we can call it something else. But it's all the same. It's the grace of God that orchestrates the evaporation of our continuity fear. That is what really takes place. So Buddha had his continuity fear evaporated through the orchestration of the grace of God. Just as anyone else who came to this world, in whatever reason they came here, continuity fear is evaporated by the grace of God. Their functioning here was through the grace of God. Exactly the same as all of us. Our escape from the continuity fear, our freedom from it, is orchestrated by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gradually evaporates it. Now, there's some who come here who have no continuity fear. They never departed into self-delusion, never tried to change reality. Those are called various terms, avatars, saviors, avatars, who born without the slightest trace of any continuity fear, and they say, we never had any continuity fear. But that too is the grace of God, showing us that we didn't have to choose to try and change reality, separate from reality. It was just our own whimsical decision to do that. But it wasn't that God forced us into doing that. the fact that avatars appear here shows that God is not trying to force us into this. Our own free will. We didn't have to choose it. Therefore, we don't have to choose it again. Once we set it down, we don't have to pick it up again and choose it again. We don't have to. We could if we want to, but we don't have to. We're free. We're totally free. We cannot limit our freedom. So sometimes there are avatars that appear here. Rarely, because usually cultures cannot understand them. Can understand, what's this? What do you mean? Again, overview, big picture. Sometimes the avatars may play with the continuity fear to see the different approaches and remedies to it, but it's a conscious play. They're doing it on purpose, consciously, to be able to relate, you know, perfectly clearly to every possible approach to resolving the continuity fear. And so it may seem they go through this process, but they themselves consciously, from a pragmatic standpoint, said, I'm going to do this from a pragmatic standpoint to be more effective or relate, you know, have a better, maybe relate better. That is possible. But they will tell you, no, I never, don't have any karma, never did I choose to go into this, you know, self-deception. This is only for the benefit of you that I'm doing this sort of thing. That's possible. That has happened. But we are not avatars, okay? We're not avatars. We did choose to go into this. So we have gone through these stages. First stage of the first bear, second bear, third bear, fourth. We're trying to get now to the awakening, Going into this calm harbor, cruising into this calm harbor. But still with this undercurrent of jitters, still with jitters. Of course, because it's getting all more and more calm, more and more clear. And we're still vibrating with the tumultuousness of the ocean, right? A little bit. It's still in our memory banks. So there's all this fizzling, you know, fizziness going on still. The drink is still somewhat fizzy. And so we're just getting used to this, wow. And then you get the vehicle of manifestation is what you get. That's the vehicle. I was shown the dream, the vehicle of manifestation, which is incomparably better than any vehicle, the high-tech technology and sophisticated fourth dimensional stuff, incomparably better than anything they can come up for you. No worry, no concern. Peace, love, freedom, calm. No worries. You have the vehicle of manifestation. Whatever it is all smooth and calm and loving and peaceful and no problem whatsoever. And it's just, you're just smoothly cruising and just enjoying every moment. That's why we're created. That's how we were created. So don't forsake that for some jingly jangly high-tech monstrosity. full of little android slaves and having to pillage worlds and take them over and conquer and battling against problems and having to struggle to be high up and don't fall down in the pecking order, get what you think you need, struggling, fighting, you know, manufacturing, oh, we're running out of resources. It's a nightmare. It's a nightmare. Fourth dimension's a nightmare. But it's got a glittery gloss to it. Just turn away from that. Turn away from that. Silly. If I just apply myself to the continuity fear and let the Holy Spirit orchestrate the evaporation of that, I'll be free of all of that fairly soon, actually. Fairly soon. Never have to deal with any of that stuff again, ever. So, that's the best deal there is. The Holy Spirit offers the best deal there is. Holy Spirit says, just give me some time and some effort and focus and concentration and determination and some perseverance. And before you know it, you'll be free of all that. Forever. You know that you're free forever. And how can you beat that deal? How can you beat that deal? It's the best deal there is. No other deal is remotely close to that. And so all you're giving up is simply all this frantic effort to have fun and be happy and do things and try to work on this vehicle you're trying to manufacture. All this frantic efforts, really. You're just giving up that. You're not really doing that so intensely, but that's not giving up anything, really. Giving up all this sensuality, this frantic sensuality of the world. Forget it, you know. That's just nothing but tumultuous thinking. Just gets worse and worse and worse. It's just a huge headache. So give up a huge headache for just some calm, focused efforts to get used to the amazing, astonishing wonderfulness of your reality, of our reality. The perfect serenity, this perfect calm. Beyond understanding. Keep aiming for that. Keep bringing your mind back to it. So you have these sustained periods where all you're doing, you keep bringing your mind back to the right focus. Keep bringing it back to the right focus. People are so freaked out on this planet right now by what's happening, by the extraterrestrial involvement, actually, which is very heavy, super involved. People have sort of blocked it out. They say, I don't want to deal with that. I don't want to think about it. I want to see it. I don't want to be aware of what's going on. And they use drugs for that. I want to be so drugged out that I can't even be aware of it. But we don't have to do it that way. We can just say, oh, that stuff's spiritual pride of those who are on the first stage of this misadventure. They're newbies, first stage of it. So I don't have a problem with any of that. I'm not even worried or concerned about it at all. I'm concerned about the continuity problem. That's it. So you have to realize that the whole ET extraterrestrial, all this stuff is on the ones who are more recently jumped into the pit of self-deception, and so they seem to carry a lot of confidence that they haven't lost this they're still carrying the feeling of reality with them to some extent of confidence. Oh, we can make this work. We can make this work. And so they're actually lower than anyone else. They're lower. Now those who are in this religious fear and stuff, they're actually higher than the ETs, because at least they've realized they have a problem. It's just that they're desperately trying to combine truth and lies. Whereas the ETs and all these, they're saying, hey, we can make lies true, there's no problem. Whereas the religious people are saying, hey, I don't think so. I think we have a problem here with God. I don't think we can make lies true, but maybe we combine them. You know, compromise. That's still a higher level of awareness than the ETs with their confidence we can make lies true. So the religious people are actually on a higher level than the ETs. And then those on the spiritual path are on a higher level than the religious people and the ETs. And those who have been awakened are the ones who, you know, that's the highest of the high. They realize, no, it was just all a dream of nothing. Nothing ever happened. So there's this massive effort in the world to make religious people and people on the spiritual path, but especially religious people, think that they're lower than the ETs, that are lower than the fourth dimensionals, they're lower than the technology people, that they're on some lower level. It's not true, they're higher. They're higher. But the ETs see the ambivalence in them, and they say, hey, we can fix this. You see, this whole technological culture fourth dimensions, we can fix this. We can fix this. We know how to make lies true. We can fix this. So they see the ambivalence of the religious people, and they say, hey, we can fix these people. We know how to fix these people. We can get them away from God, you know. There's no worries. Why are you worried this way? We can make lies true. There's no continuity fear. And so the religious people are feeling very threatened by the ET fourth dimensionals here. Very threatened by them. It's a tremendous battle going on. Whereas those on the spiritual path don't really feel threatened. Don't really feel that threatened. It's an annoyance. You know, I don't like it, it's an annoyance. But threatened? No, they don't feel threatened. They don't feel, you know, hostile or angry. They don't have this mindset. I don't have that mindset. Certainly, I realize that it's a massive attempt at delay, which is not good. But I must say, am I going to be dragged down? No. Not if I keep on keeping on and being disciplined like this. So again, the big picture. So the religious people, where they go when they pass away, they go to the land afterlife where it seems as both truth and lies are true, where there seems to be this harmonious somehow, both truth and lies are true. They go into this situation, and of course that's not true. So eventually they have to work that out more intensely, which they find themselves identifying again with the body in the gross, dense levels of the dream. What about those on the spiritual path? Where do they go? Well, those who are really on the path, they go, in Buddhism they say the once returners, sometimes there are those who return one more time. Because they're sort of slowly on the path. When you're sort of slowly on the path, if you're going to go slow, you're likely to return one more time to this type of realm. If you're on fast track, really fast track spiritual path, then there's no need to return to this sort of realm, and you find yourself in the what I call the paradise realm or the death-free realms. You seem to have a life in the death-free realms. You know, just incredible feel to that. It's just awesome, astonishing. The perfection, the peace, the untroubledness, just totally astonishing. You just absorb in this astonishment, like, wow, it's just incredible, wow. And then they then return to the true formlessness of reality. From there. And of course, those who are the lowest of ventures, who are, you know, still think they can make lies true, they keep returning to the physical realm quickly. They quickly return after they die. They quickly come back. And they can't wait. They're eager. They say, no, I want to prove you guys I'm better than you. I can compete with God. I'm better than God. And I can make lies true. So they incarnate over and over and over, more and more and more, you know, just boom, 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 keep coming back. And finally, they get tired of it. Now, the religious people, what happens when they die? They may reincarnate, you know, several more times, until they, once they get started on the spiritual path, then, you know, maybe just one more time. I remember for me, my teachers always said, go fast, we're fast-tracking you, you're being fast-tracked. So just go. This is your last life here. Go fast. So I was fast-tracked. My whole life has been fast-tracked. So just super intense. Not a normal life at all. Just continuously not resting on any of the laurels. Just every day is, you know, just a total challenge. Got to go, you know, deeper. Have to work more intensely. Have to make more progress. Have to get work on this, evaporate this continuity problem. More. Come on. Don't get lazy. So just this relentless non-laziness. Relentless. Never a day off in my life. Never a day off. Never had a single day off in my whole life. So this is what happens. This is what happens when, you know, you're fast-tracked and you're not going to have another birth here in these type of realms. And sensuality cannot seduce you back into these realms, which is how we get seduced. As the voice of sensuality tickles us and we then rationalize this as that we're going to come here and save the world. But really, we end up being pulled down into the arrogance and conceit and spiritual pride of this world, thinking that they can, you know, solve the problems, fix the problems without the grace of God. And that they say, you can be a hero and help us do this. And then you say, wow. And then comes a nightmare. So you have to get free of sensuality in order to not return to this world, for sure. The sirens are always singing their song. The siren song of sensuality is always singing its song, trying to lull, pull people, heroes, into this world to motivate the beginners here, to motivate this pride here. I said, we can fix it. We don't need God. We're better than God. We can make this, fix this so we're happy. But we need heroes. We need motivators here. So come here and play your song, your music, do your motivational, charisma, do everything you can do to keep people believing we can fix the problems on our own, that kind of thing. So the sensuality is the carrot, you know, is the sweet that lures you back into the situation. So in order to not get lured back, you have to break the spell of sensuality here. Once that is broken, then you cannot be lured back into this world, actually. the sensuality of the world is an expression of spiritual pride, which is a refusal to recognize the continuity problem. Religious people are coming from God, but they realize that, wow, you know, I'm doing something wrong. And so they do pass all these laws and very disciplined about sensuality. So I say, well, we need to, like, you know, severely curtail the sensuality so we can figure this out. You know, I think I got a severe problem with God here, and we need to really figure this out. So they put limits on sensuality for sure. Which is very helpful. Eventually that's helpful. Eventually it's helpful to get on the spiritual path then. And for a while maybe they think, okay, well, those limits on sensuality weren't really necessary, because no, they're actually very helpful. Very helpful. So as you go on the spiritual path, you may seem less religious for a while and fall into various traps. Because the prideful ones think, oh good, you're coming back to our side now, not realizing that there is a spiritual path that leads to liberation. They assume that you've finally woken up from your stupidity. You know, you stop believing in God, this crazy God's angry with you. And so for a while you might be confused about this. You say, well wait a minute. Yeah, I don't believe that God created bodies and this universe and impermanence and death. And I don't believe God's angry with us, or we need to, you know, we're sinful in relation to God. I don't believe any of that. So the spiritual, the ones who want to be greater than God, who are still very much into that, They congratulate you and say, oh great, you finally freed yourself from the silly delusion of God. And so now you're one of us and you can help us. And you get confused over this. You get very unstable, like, well, wait a minute. You know, I'm not... What you're doing is you are accepting you have a continuity problem. That doesn't mean you don't believe in God. It means you recognize that you can't change God, and therefore we have a continuity problem, because we believe we were able to, we've been changing God, changing reality. So you do have to relinquish the image of a changed God, which religious people are worshiping, the image of a changed God, trying to relate to a changed God. You're relinquishing that, but you're not relinquishing the true God at all, the unchangeable God. The unchangeable God. You're not relinquishing that. You're accepting it. So the pagan, humanistic, lustful, sensuous, prideful, spiritually prideful ones, you can fall back. You can sort of, they can get their hooks into you once you realize religion is not really the answer. Per se, it's trying to come to terms with the image of a changed God, which isn't the answer. You can struggle in your life, actually, which is what happened to me. You can struggle. And the Holy Spirit helps orchestrate your freedom from that struggle. Because the secular, humanistic, atheistic, pagan, prideful ones who want to replace God with an image, their own image of God, want to, you know, separate from God, create separately, create differently. They don't recognize any such thing as a spiritual path, because they say, well, there's no God to go back to. What are you talking about? We've replaced that God. So they automatically assume that you're one of them. And so you need to, you know, embrace that. And they say, we're here to help you, you know, recover your sanity. And that's very confusing and difficult. And you may pick up a lot of pagan friends that you have to drop. You have to drop them along the way because they're very bad influences. And they'll see you're struggling and say, hey, what you need is drugs. You need drugs. That'll help you, cure you of you're just sad about losing God, you know, their image of God, religious image of God. And then the more you can say, no, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a God problem. I have a continuity problem. Sure, God, the unchangeable God is. And so I have a continuity problem with that. I don't have a religious God problem, I have a continuity problem. So gradually you're able to stand up to these barbarians, you know, these prideful barbarians, really. And they say no and push their bullying back. They're very much in a bullying mode in this world now. You're trying to bully everyone. Well, they'll bully whoever they can. A bully bullies whoever they can bully. And you have to stand up to them and say, no, you're not bullying me. Then they'll just leave you alone. Leave you alone. You see, these prideful ones, they think like those on the spiritual path can help them. They think, look, you can help us help get rid of this religious nonsense in the world, right? But remember, because you see, you don't believe that stuff, right? But remember that religious people are actually a step higher because at least they're realizing there's a problem. See, uh-oh. They call it sin. It's really the continuity problem, but they've not been able to identify it properly. But they do realize that's higher. They're at a higher stage. So there's no way I'm going to undermine the higher stage that way. I'm not going to help, you know, the pagans, you know, destroy religion. I'm not going to help them with that. I'm going to help the religious, the ones who are entering the path, encourage them, motivate, you know, hey, and help them, because it's a rocky road. It's a rocky road because they'll be set upon by the secular materialists and say, good, you finally got over that insanity. So it's tough to leave religion for the spiritual path. Very difficult, actually, which is why many right now who want to leave the religious encampment for the spiritual path that leads to true liberation, which is accepting God as God is, truly is, which is the isness of reality, the uncaused isness, the causeless isness of reality. It can't be changed. They have a very hard time leaving because the pagan sees upon them. Say, God, finally, all that terrible ethics and morality and restrictions on sensuality stuff. See, that was all crazy. Now enjoy yourself, indulge. What were you thinking? You know, you were insane. And there's this massive propaganda machine aimed at religious people right now. So I do attend church as a way of solidarity with saying, no, I'm not going to attack religion. I don't attack religion. I offer clarification. But I do support the institutions of religion because it is a necessary step out of this severe prideful self-deceit that we start out with. We all start out with thinking, hey, we can be separate from God. There is a way. We can do it. We can do anything. Nothing's impossible for us. And then that way has to give way to a religious reorientation. Religion is just a reorientation of saying, wait a minute, I've got a problem here. That's all I say, well, there's a problem with this. But they haven't yet identified what the problem is. That comes on the spiritual path. And the spiritual path comes from the Holy Spirit, which says, look, I know what the problem really is, and I'll help you see what it is. And then you gradually clarify what the whole situation is all about. So when I talk about religion, I'm not saying get rid of it. I'm saying absolutely don't get rid of it. I'm saying let's make it possible to take the spiritual path of recognition of the Holy Spirit, recognizing what our problem really is. First stage is to say, I've got a problem. Second stage is to see clearly what it is. Third stage is to gently set it down, to evaporate it, okay? All that's necessary, it's totally necessary. So as I'm in church, Catholic church, seeing everything, I say, my God, they're all so confused. You know, it's just like, it's, whew. Mixing truth and lies, and then saying you need to have faith in this. You know, I just say, oh God, please not again. It's really tough. But I see that these people are trying to accept that they do have a problem. They're trying to get free of their pride, you see. It's a step. It's a necessary step. So I support it. I say, hey, I wish blessings of the Holy Spirit upon everyone here. For sure. All blessings upon everyone. May the Holy Spirit be with all of you, all of your days of your life. And gradually evaporate this continuity fear that you have. It's a tumultuous time in the world. There's this tremendous attempt to wipe out religion on this planet. And religion feels themselves so attacked in this way that they're not really open to anybody trying to clarify the deficiencies they have so they can understand how they need to. This has to expand into a genuine spiritual path. They're not really, they're so besieged, they're really not interested in that. They're sort of circling the wagons. What they're doing is they're trying to, what they always have done is try to just incorporate the secular materialism into the liturgy, into the everything, and just sort of absorb it. That's what the Pope is doing. The secular materialists love the Pope. Maybe more than a lot of Catholics love the Pope, actually. Because the secular materialists say, oh, the Pope is great. He's doing our work for us. This is exactly what we want. Now, that may not be the motive of the Pope. The Pope's motive may be to move people to a spiritual path. That's possible. But that's not how the secular materialists are seeing it. They see, like, wow, this is our opportunity. So it's a tricky game that's going on. Very tricky game. I'm not denigrating the Pope. I'm not sure exactly what the motivation is here. Is it to pressure the church to actually get on the real spiritual path, or is it actually pressuring the church to be more inclusive, to maintain their institution, the structure of the institution? Let's just include all these pagans and we'll kind of water everything down to make them feel more welcome. Is that what's going on? It is a question, isn't it? But certainly the pagans feel very emboldened by this, what's going on. They feel that they're routing, you know, Christianity, they're routing religion on the planet. Really, religion is in retreat, extreme retreat. But in any case, whatever is happening, our only problem is the continuity problem. That's the only problem anyone has. They're just all misidentifying it. The pagans misidentify it. The religious people misidentify it. Those on the spiritual path are gradually getting clear about it. Those who have awakened, they know it. They know it. Seeing the known is enlightenment. Seeing the known. Seeing the known is true awareness. It's right now. The isness is right now. The fact that any number times zero is zero is true right now. You don't have to wait for them to multiply it, because there's no multiplication. You see, the idea we need time to let this work out is not really true. How long do we need for zero times 1,000 to be zero? No time at all, do we? We know, already know it's zero. So that's why it's possible right now to be enlightened right now. No matter what's happening in the world, we can know it's zero. Zero change to reality can be known right now without another moment passing. We don't have to wait for it to work out. We don't have to say, well, I better wait until this a billion times zero has worked out its calculations, its multiplication of that. No, it's zero right now. This instant we know it's zero. So we know the end of everything right now. From the beginning it's all been known. It's zero. We don't have to pay any attention to all this multiplication. People say, now wait a minute. You know, they don't recognize it's zero. They say, no, wait a minute. Why are you multiplying it times a billion and someone else is multiplying it by 100,000? What's going on here? What's the significance of this difference here? That's where they're lost. And so they keep thinking there's significance taking place. There's no significance taking place. Everywhereness is everywhereness right now. Oneness is oneness right now. The zeroness of delusion, of change in that isness, is zeroness right now. And yet the whole world is up in the air about, wow, you're multiplying, you've got a multiplication factor of 25 and I've got 30. Why is this difference? What does this difference signify? What does this difference signify? What does this difference mean to us? So the whole world is asking, what are these differences mean? What's the meaning of this? And say, well, let's give it some time to work out and see what happens. See what kind of meaning comes of all this stuff, all these different multiplying factors. Let's see what kind of difference comes. I'm interested in it. Now, we can know right now there's no meaning or significance whatsoever. It's zero right now. Right? We can be on the level of knowing, on the vertical axis of knowing. It's zero. Don't have to give any thought to it. We don't have to give any thought to it whatsoever. Any thought given to it, it is arrogance, self-pride, is delusion, self-deception. Whimsicality. Only the whimsical, only whimsicality could be obsessed with the differences of multiplying all these multiplying factors and overlook the fact that these multiplying factors are being applied to zero, which means they have to be zero. There isn't any other result possible. And that zero, since there's no other result possible, that the result is right here now. It's always right here now. All of this thinking and thinking and judging and differentiation and referencing, all this duality is a complete waste of time. Total waste of time. So we can say, I am perfectly calm. Everything is zero right now. It's all zero right now. I'm perfectly calm. I don't need to wait for any result. I'm perfectly calm. I don't need to wait for any result. I know. There's zero change right now. The change in reality is zero right now. Zero change right now. I'm perfectly calm. I don't need to wait for any result. I know the result right now. I'm perfectly calm because I know the result right now. This is, you're using your will to accelerate your path by rehearsing the result that you want instead of waiting for it. Don't wait, rehearse. Don't wait, rehearse. I'm perfectly calm. I am calm. The result that I want is here right now. The result that I really want is here right now. I am calm. The result that I really want is here right now. I know it's here right now. I am calm. The result that I really want, I know is here right now. It's here right now and I know it. The result that I want is here right now. And I know this. I know it. I know it. So I am calm. I know it. I am calm. The result that I really want is here right now. I know it. I am calm. The vision of oneness is here right now. I know it. I know this is true. I am calm. The result that I want is here right now. I know this is true. So this is rehearsal. And you won't feel the calm when you're rehearsing. But you are definitely stepping in the new territory as you rehearse this way. Saving a vast amount of time because you're no longer waiting. You're making a statement, I'm not going to wait any longer for any result because the result is here right now. And it will always be the same. So waiting is nothing but an insanely extravagant whimsicality. And is really, I'm doing it because I'm afraid. I haven't rehearsed. I'm afraid of a continuity problem, but I'm no longer afraid. The result that I want, I know it's here right now. I know it's here right now. I know it is here right now. I don't think it's here. I know it's here. So you don't say, I think it's here. No, I know that it is here. It has to be, right? There's no thinking. You don't need to think about all these multiplying factors times zero. You don't need to think each one. Okay, I think one times zero, zero. I think 100 times zero, zero. I think 99 times zero, zero. I think a billion times zero. I think. Now, I know zero times anything is zero. I know it. End of thinking. Therefore, I'm calm. I have peace of mind. I am calm. I have peace of mind right now. I know that I have this right now. I know my peace of calm. I know I have it. I don't think I have it. I know I have it. So this is the step we're getting to. I am calm. This is we're rehearsing how we're going to feel. I know I am calm. I know I am calm. I am calm and I know it. I don't think it, I know it. So to go from thinking to knowing is the big step we're trying to take, is the shift. Once we accept it's a knowing, then the vision of oneness will be there for us for sure. I've already shifted a couple times. It's there for us. And there's no need for thinking of it. I know it. And that's the astonishment of it. Like, wow. is effortless. Because I know it, I'm accepting, I know it. Thinking is a delaying tactic. The spiritual path is where we get on saying, okay, I think that 100 times 0 is 0, okay, I think that's right. And you say, wow, okay, I think I just had a breakthrough. And then you say, I think that 963 times 0 is 0. And you say, wow, another breakthrough. And I think that 157,821, that times 0, I think that is 0 too. Okay, and so you go through these years and years and years of, I think that's also 0, and I think that's also 0. And gradually the Holy Spirit says, hey, maybe it's all 0. And you don't have to think about all this separately. You don't have to think about it separately on this linear path of all these different quantities. You can think about it vertically of, let's just all say that all quantities, all values times 0 value are 0 value. And therefore, this one statement takes care of it all. So you don't need time. You can know it right now. You can know it right now. You can shift the knowing. I know that I don't know anything. See, I know that I don't know anything, meaning all these values have no value. I don't know any value. I know that I don't know anything, any value. I know, see, it's basically saying, I know 0. I know 0. I know 0 change in reality. I know 0 change in reality. I know 0 times 0 is 0. So this shifts out of our thinkingness into our knowingness. And in the knowingness is the vision of oneness, is intrinsically what we know. Now we may think we're seeing it, which is fine. That's the 0 times the 0. We're saying, wow, I think this is right. That's the knowing, actually. But I know that I don't know anything. I know that I don't know any value. I only know 0. 0 change. 0 time. 0 time space. So I am calm. I know that I am calm. I know that I don't know anything. I know that I don't know anything. I am calm. Everything is calm. There's only calmness. There's only this perfect serenity. The stupendous, amazing serenity. There's only the stupendous, amazing serenity. This is another way to practice. I know that there's only the stupendous, amazing serenity. No thoughts arising. This stupendous, amazing serenity, this smoothed out smoothness, that is all there is. That is all there is to see. And that is what I'm experiencing. So we rehearse, rehearse, rehearse. Spiritual path is one of gradually going from thinking to rehearsing to then realizing, experiencing. And it's a gradual process, gradual, gradually. For me, I thought for a long time and gradually started practicing. Gradually started rehearsing. See, you don't have to stop thinking, but more and more you go towards rehearsing and practicing. And your thinking brings you right to that quickly, quickly, quickly. So again, big picture, big picture, big picture. Now the ego tries to make you give up because it's difficult. The ones who have awakened, the avatars, the saviors, the awakened ones, etc., they're helpful because you know you can do it. You say, if they did it, I can do it. I know this is possible, I'm going to do it, but so I'm not going to give up. Many times the ego tried, you know, I felt like I need to give up, this is too difficult. I said, no, I'm not going to give up, I know it's possible. And then you push the ego aside and keep working. Today the ego will try to make me give up. It's always trying. Give up. It's too difficult. You can't succeed. And say, no, I can. All I see is this stupendous, clear, smoothed out serenity. That's all I see. Everywhere. I don't need to think about it either. It's unmultiplied serenity. We don't need to multiply isness. We don't need to expand isness because isness always is the case. Creation is the expansion of adventure, etc. But the isness is always, the pure spaciousness always is the case. It's the underlying idea of it. We don't need to multiply that or expand that. So the ground of being is always as it is. The fact that we are co-creators always is that fact. That fact doesn't need to be expanded or contracted, nothing. No. It always just is what it is. Now you might say, well, I don't understand this stuff. Well, it's a rehearsal. Just rehearse as if you did understand it. Just aware that you don't quite understand it. But as you rehearse it, you say, that's not too difficult. I can probably understand that. Give it a little time. Give it a little time. It'll sink in. So in the vision of oneness, it's not that you are clear, it's everywhere is clear. Everyone is clear. There's only clarity everywhere. It's not my clarity or your clarity. It's everywhere clarity. It's everywhere serenity. We've stopped thinking about it and simply knowing it. As long as we're saying, well, yeah, I think I know that a billion times 0 is 0, hey, but I think also think that 999 times 0 is 0, I also think, we're not actually experiencing the clarity, the zero times zeroness. So dropping that I think I know this, to knowing it, that's when one enters into the vision of oneness. I haven't done that yet, so I'm just hashing this out here live. So we're doing live meditation, which is how I feel I can do it. If I try to be just silent, it's too difficult. I seem to be able to do it better like this way. Because in a previous life, I was a performer, a virtuoso. I tend to, that's just the way, you know, my tendencies is to be able to, you know, present it live, like a performance, like I'm doing something. So I just do live meditation. But others will do, you know, silent meditation. They feel they make progress that way. So it's everywhere, clearness is a oneness. It's everywhere, everywhereness. Like, wow, there's everywhere, everywhereness. There's right now, nowness. This is right now, everywhere, everywhereness, right now, nowness. This is right now, nowness. Everywhere, everywhereness. This is everywhere, everywhereness I'm experiencing. This is sereneness that I'm experiencing. In other words, it's not my everywhereness, it's everywhere, everywhereness. The thinking gave us the idea of the mind. So I think that 999,000 times zero is zero. So I'm identified with this 999,000. I'm looking at this, I say, wow, that times everywhereness, that times zero is zero. So we're still identified with a location, quantity, location, in relation to everywhereness. But when we drop that and say it's all zero, then there's just this one zero times zero-ness, everywhereness. Unquantifiable, unquantified awareness, everywhereness. There isn't any discoveries to be made anymore. That's the final discovery, is that there are no discoveries to be made. There are no necessary discoveries. There's nothing necessary we need to discover about reality. Reality is undiscoverable because it totally is. There's nothing hidden, so there's nothing to discover, actually. So we kind of give up, you know, all this discovery. There is never anything to discover. There is never any discovery. This is, I guess, maybe the final realization. There was never any discovery. We thought we could discover that there was a way to create separately from God, and we just had to discover it. There isn't. So there's nothing to discover, actually. So the habit of discovery, and maybe the strongest one we have, so we're discovering, hey, 950,000 times zero, zero. Wow, what a great discovery I made. And this can go on for a long time until we recognize, hey, everything times zero, zero, there's no discovery there. I can discover zero times zero, zero. Okay, well, that's the final discovery. Hey, zero times zero is zero. Everywhereness is everywhere. That's the final discovery. Everywhereness is everywhere. Nowness is right now. Wow, right, nowness is right now. Everywhereness is everywhere. So let us have this final discovery. Zero times zero is zero. So we allow ourselves this final discovery. The discovery of no discovery. So just managing the wow factor of this. That's all. You take a break, just manage the wow factor. Very humbling. There is no discovery to make. Except the discovery of no discovery. The adventure of no adventure is what we did. Done discovery of no discovery. The adventure of no adventure. The fear of no fear. The sleep of no sleep. The everywhereness of everywhereness. Hey, I've discovered the everywhereness of everywhereness. Yeah, that's it. See, this too is within everywhereness. This too is within everywhereness. So we can shift to knowing. I've just sort of shown that it's pretty obvious that we no longer. We don't have to keep thinking. We've discovered that one more value times zero is zero. At some point we can say, hey, you know what, I think, I'll call it good. All values times zero is zero. I don't need to discover anymore. Keep discovering each one individually. And then that saves a lot of time, doesn't it? Imagine how much time it saves when we decide, you know what, I think all values times zero are zero. So I'm not going to spend any more time in discovering that each number times zero is zero, because that could go on infinitely, right? So basically, we're saving ourselves infinite time, by saying all values times zero is zero. So we can save infinite time. Infinite delay, actually. Videos. I don't know how long it is, but this Memorial Day, you see, spending the day, the morning this way. Now, there'll be some, you know, there's some functions today, etc. But at least I gave it a good push today, you see. You have to give it a really good push. Now, could I do more? Absolutely. I want to do more. So I just say, Holy Spirit, help me do more today. And don't quit on this. You know, keep going, keep going, keep going. The everywhereness of everywhereness. The discovery of no discovery. Wow. Very beautiful day today. Soft breezes, very warm, soft breezes, crystal clear sky. It's a pity that we live on earthquake faults, that you never know when they're going to snap. And all of us, you know, beautiful infrastructure could be, you know, torn apart any moment. So it's... never at ease here in California, actually. Ignorance is bliss here. Those who come out here and never experience an earthquake, they think, oh, this is great, and they're so competent and wonderful. You know, then a big quake hits. It's like, whoa. End of innocence, you know. End of innocence. I got really upset when the 89 quake hit. I was so angry because I realized I never can view this area the same way again. No way. It's impossible. Because what seems stable, the ground, suddenly the ground is like an ocean. It's really like being on the ocean. It's just rocking like waves. And you just realize, wow, the ground is not stable. All this underground, everything's underground, pipes, everything, they could all snap, actually. They could all pull apart. You could have a complete infrastructure meltdown here. if you get a big enough quake. You know, the one we had was it like 6.9 or something? Loma Prieta quake, 89. You know, it was strong, but not really big. You get like a 7.1, 7.5, you know, anything with sevens, or if an 8, you know, that is like 100 times more, you know, just exponentially, 1,000 times stronger, it goes exponentially. So you get a real, like an 8.3 or whatever. That would just really snap the infrastructure. And paradise turned into a nightmare. At that point, it doesn't matter how nice the day is, you know, it's a nightmare. So, back to the nightmare world to some extent here. Realizing the everywhere of everywhereness. Everywhere of everywhereness. I know. I know. I am calm because I know. I am calm because now I know. I am calm because now I know. I've chosen to know instead of think. Thinking is this. I discovered this. Constant process of discovery. 1,000 times 0, 0. 1,001 times 0, 0. 1,002 times 0, 0. 1,003 times 0, 0. 1,004. That's thinking. Knowing is all values times 0 is 0. Right now. That's it. That's knowing. So I'm calm because I know. I am calm because I know. I am calm because I know. All is calm because I know. I am calm because I know. All is calm because I know. I am calm because I know. All is calm because knowing is. I am calm because I know. All is calm because knowing is. All right, let that shift to knowing be now. All right, that's it.